For this video, we are going to summarize the equations we've used so far in chapter 16 for thermodynamics. And in this list of equations, I'm highlighting in here the ones that are not included on your equation sheet. So for example, equation number one, although a straightforward equation, it is technically not on your equation sheet. Same for equation number two and four. And so the equations I have numbered here, I've numbered them in the order that we've covered them. So again, recognize that one, two, and four are all the same format, just plugging in different values for these. And I also have a side note here for each one on how we're determining the sig figs in our answer. So again, notice for one, two, and four, because the main math function in here is addition and subtraction, we'll go by least decimal places as we report our final answers. Equation number three is on your equation sheet, and that one is specifically listed as standard form. So that's how it's listed on your equation sheet, but recognize that you could use it in the non-standard form. So it's the same equation for either version of that. From equation three, we did derive the equation to solve for temperature. This can be used to solve for the temperature of a phase change or to determine the temperature at which a reaction will change spontaneity. So for this one, for temperature, we will use sig figs because we are dividing in there. But for simplicity's sake, in number three, because our last step is subtraction in here, we're going to go by decimal places of our original enthalpy and entropy values. And our last two equations, number five, this is the one where we're using our standard delta G to calculate the non-standard delta G. Since our last step is addition here, we're going to report our sig figs for non-standard delta G by looking at the number of decimal places in the standard delta G. And our very last equation is relating our equilibrium constant to our standard delta G. Since we are using multiplication in here, we're just going to go by sig figs. So this is a great summary slide of the equations that we're using. And so the last step that we have in here is to practice the last two equations that we have not used yet. So in here, notice we are given standard delta G for the dissociation of acetic acid as this quantity. Here we have our equation. And we want to calculate the equilibrium constant Ka, of course, remembering that this is a subscript of A because we're working with acetic acid in here. Since we are given delta G naught and asked to find our equilibrium constant, we're going to use this equation. And remember that any subscript for K works in this equation. Now in this one, two things. One is that I like to predict my value of K before I start calculating based on the value of delta G naught. So recognize a positive delta G naught tells us that this is a reactant favored system. So anytime we have a reactant favored system, we expect our K to be a small value. I should get a value less than one for K. The second thing is that I like to manipulate this mathematical equation to solve for the ln of k, plugging in these values, and then take the e of both sides to isolate k. You, of course, are welcome to raise both sides to the e first and then plug in values, depending on how comfortable you are with setting up multiple operations in your calculator. Now, the most common mistake I see students make is forgetting to carry this negative through, and that's why it's helpful to predict this k value. If you forget that negative, you'll get the opposite value of k from what we predict or expect. And again, because we're working with kilojoules in the numerator for our delta G, I'm going to convert our R value into kilojoules per mole per Kelvin. And multiply by our temperature. Notice in this question, we're not given temperature, but because we are given standard delta G, we can infer that we are using our 298. You have the optional 0.15. I will tell you for K values, whether you use the 0.15 or not will change your value. So for purposes of showing work, make sure you show me which one you're using so that I can make sure I'm grading your value correctly. And so when we plug all of this in, realize we should get a negative value here because of our signs, right? We have a plus for the delta G naught and a negative in the denominator. For this, we get a value of negative 10.9326 in the ballpark, again, depending on which temperature value you used. And so again, that value is our ln of K. And so to solve for K itself, we raise both sides to the E. And therefore, our K is, we're going by sig figs here. And the only value we were given was our delta G naught. So I'm going to report to 3 sig figs. We get 1.79 times 10 to the minus 5. Again, using sig figs in our delta G to determine the sig figs in our K. And if we were to look up values, this is actually the value for the Ka of acetic acid. Our last practice calculation is using the same system. We still have the same delta G naught. Now we want to know if the reaction is spontaneous under these conditions. And so what's implied here, remember that non-standard delta G determines spontaneity. So we need to calculate our non-standard delta G to determine the direction this reaction is going. In other words, is it still going forward or is it going in the reverse? We are given a different temperature, so we do need to calculate that. Temperature, of course, is going to be 95 plus our 273.15, and that will give us a value of 368.15. We also need to set up our Q. Let's reformat that. So remember that Q is going to be set up as products over reactants. Everything raised to the exponent of its coefficient. Everything is a 1 in this equation. So we get those values. And so when I calculate Q, I'm going to plug in these concentrations. And so when we calculate that, Q comes out to be a value of 9.782 times 10 to the minus 4. So now we have all the values we need to plug everything in. So our setup is going to look like this. We have 27.1 kilojoules per mole for our delta G naught value. Again, remember that's positive. We're adding to that our R times T times ln Q. Again, I'm going to convert my R into kilojoules so that it will match the kilojoules of delta G naught. Multiplying by our temperature, 368.15, and then times the ln of our Q value. So I recommend pause the video, plug all of that in. When you get an answer, replay again. When you plug all of those quantities in, remember that for our final answer here, we're going to use the decimal places in our delta G naught to determine decimal places in our answer. So we're going to go to one decimal place. And notice here we are left with units of kilojoules per mole, or Kelvin. Oh, forgot to include it here. Kelvins from the temperature cancel out. And so we get a final delta G of positive 5.9 kilojoules per mole. And remember that a positive delta G indicates that this is a non-spontaneous reaction. Remember, spontaneous means it's moving forward toward equilibrium. That means that this reaction must be moving in the reverse direction. So in other words, we have too much product, we need to make more reactant, and so it's going in the reverse to reach equilibrium. A great extra practice problem for you is example 1611 in the OpenStax textbook.